There it is. It works better if you turn it on. How's everybody doing this morning? We had some nasty weather last Sunday, didn't we? We still had about 120 show up. It was awesome. And we did a worship service. We just sang the whole service and praised our Lord and thanked Him for everything He's done and He's going to do. So I had a sermon today that it's just I've been excited about a couple weeks, and I just wanted the bulk of us to hear it. So that's why we did that worship service last Sunday, in hopes that the most of us to be here today. It's going to be on prayer, so I'm excited to do that with us. Have you come to worship the Lord? Well, that's good. Some of you are excited. I'm going to have Pat put up our scripture, 2 Corinthians 9. And we don't bring up money a lot here. We want everybody to be prepared to give with a cheerful heart. I've been in several churches where money is preached, and you know, we're the church, and we've got bills just like businesses, and we need to have you guys give and all that. That's baloney. Everything's God's. This building, our lives, our breath, our money, everything we have is God's. So I look at it from a little different perspective. We planted this church to restore people that have been hurt by the church. And a lot of that has been over money. And I know when I was doing my Paul and Timothy, one of my things I had to do to finish my pastoral training was we had to come an offering on Monday morning. And I would open up envelope after envelope, and there wasn't any money in it. And I said, Lord, if I ever get in a place that you would call me, little did I know He was gonna, to be in a church will not put people in a compromised position like that. To where they feel like they're the person to the right or the left of them has to influence them whether they have a cheerful heart to give or not. So we don't take an offering up here for those of you that are guests. We ask you to come in here prepared to give. A lot of people I'll talk to, yeah, all that church wants is our money, and we don't go there anymore. But you don't have that reason here. We don't ever put pressure on you. There are envelopes in the chairs here, and there's an offering table out there just around the double doors there at the entrance. And we want you to drop your offering in there and give it to the Lord. And here's why we've adopted this scripture here. It says, remember this, whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. And whoever sows generously will also reap generously. This whole thing, this faith walk we do that we call Christianity, Jesus used scripture from an agricultural standpoint because everybody would plant and reap and sow. So He would talk to people on a perspective of reaping and sowing. And how many know that if a farmer only plants a 100-foot row of corn, that's all he's going to harvest? If he plants 100 acres, oh my gosh, is the harvest awesome. We reap what we sow. Each man should give what he's decided in his heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. Each man should give what he's put in his heart. And that's what we want to teach here at Destiny Family of Faith, that we want you to come in here prepared to give. The first thing that we do is give to the Lord off the top of our increase. Now, some of us get a check every week, some every 2 weeks, some of us are monthly, some of us are on commission. So, if you're on a monthly commission check, you can comfortably sit beside your neighbor and not give for 3 weeks. It's none of their business. We can't judge if people, the guy beside us or the gal beside us next, are tithing or not, because it's none of their business. It depends on how they get paid, how their increase is. So we want a comfortable atmosphere here at Destiny Family and Faith. And we know that God has provided this building, this property for us, all the chairs, the heat. We know that He's provided all that, and it's all His, and He wants us to prosper. And God is able to make all grace abound to you so that in all things, at all times, having all that you need, you will abound in every good work. And He's saying here that if you keep Me first, everything you do, does it not say all, what, 1, 2, 3 times? Everything we do is the Lord's. And everything we set out to do will prosper if we keep Him first. And you know, it looks kind of bad when you look at our deposits when we get these snow days. Not everybody tithes. They're not here. The crowds have been down the last couple of weeks. But we know that God's faithful, and that money's going to come because it's all His. But I just wanted to refresh in our minds, and we've got a lot of new faces every week here. They expect us to pass an offering bag, and we don't do that here. We just ask you to fill it out and drop it in the box out there, and then you will reap what you sow. Is everybody okay with that?
Yeah.
Cool. That brings us to worship. Another part of worship is singing praises to our Lord and Savior. There are different ways that we worship. We worship with our tithes and offerings. We worship with singing. We worship with serving the Lord. There are different ways. But we're going to have the worship team come up now, and they're going to lead us into worship. Our worship team has an awesome responsibility. It sets the stage, the spiritual mindset of all of us, for the message that God's prepared for us. It's a big demand, a serious calling for our worship team, and they take it seriously. I picked the scripture this morning in Psalm 59. It's verses 16 to 17. It says, "But I will sing of your strength in the morning. I will sing of your love, for you are my fortress, my refuge in times of trouble. O my strength, I sing praise to you. You, O God, are my fortress, my loving God." I thought, what an awesome scripture that is. It calls God our strength in the morning. Have any of you ever woke up in the morning and just didn't want to go out the door? You're thinking, oh, Lord, how can I face another day? And it says here He's our strength in the morning. He gives us the grace, the ability to get up and go one more day. Our mercies and grace are new each and every day, and I think that's awesome. It's refreshing to me. It gives me that strength I need. It says He's love. God is love. And there are many of us in here that have so-called friends that we think will love us, and don't they let us down from time to time? We have a God that is love. And then it says He's my fortress and my refuge. And I don't know about you, but there are days I don't feel safe. And if I can just get on my knees and call to the Lord and acknowledge Him as my fortress, as my strength, as my refuge, then I have that power, that ability to stretch out and do. I'm in Christ deep enough that it doesn't matter what anybody else wants to do or say to me. I know that God is my refuge and my strength. So let's see where the worship takes us this morning.
Good morning, everyone. Would you please stand with us? This all morning too. There we go.
I never sin, suffered as if he did.
Overcome, and Jesus is overcome, and it's just really refreshing to know that we have a purpose. He has plans for each one of us to use us for His glory and His honor. Lord.
Like never before.
Lord, we await your return. Your word tells us that just as you ascended, you'll descend. You'll come for us. And Lord, what a glorious day that'll be. We thank you that you are truth, that we can count on your word, that we know we have promises of life everlasting. Father, we thank you so much that you, in the beginning, had your Son ready to come and save each and one of us. Lord, we'll be eternally, forever grateful. There are no words to express how we feel this morning, how grateful we are, how blessed we are to have you as Father. Lord, there are hearts in here that need you more this morning than they've ever needed you before. And I pray your Holy Spirit will settle down over each and every one of us right where we're at this morning. That you'll minister your word to each one of our hearts and our minds as we need it today. Lord, your word's the same. It never changes. And we can count on you as the way, the truth, and the life. So Lord, we humbly come to you and ask you to show us your will and your way this morning. And help us to be strong enough to walk it and talk it and live it. And we'll give you the praise, the glory, and the honor for all of it. We're going to do it in your Son, Jesus' name. Amen. Love on somebody before you sit down.
I'll just start getting a cramp for a minute.
We've got an awesome kids' church if you want to send your young ones back to the platform. I've got a few announcements I'd like to make. We've planned Winter Wonderland. Melissa's kind of decorated the sanctuary and getting some different things up. And we've got some foam, sheets of foam in the back, and we're going to make some mountain scenes up here. If any of you have theater experience, set design, that kind of stuff, use your gifting. Help us out. Melissa could use some help. We could use some team leaders and just different kinds of things with the kids. It's going to be a really neat time and a good way to draw in and become community and family. So that's going to be February 18th, 19th, and the 20th. It'll be a really good time. Rachel Roos has got a salt ministry, and it's kind of neat. It's bagged meals. And people that are down and out, we took some to Matt and Julie Taylor. They got little Darius down to the hospital now with surgery. And you can throw those things in a crock pot and warm them up, and you got a full ready meal. It's really a neat ministry that they're doing. They're going to do that again on the 14th. And they're also, her and Zach are starting a small group too. So there are sign-up sheets out there for the small groups. And if you're wondering what you can bring in to help with that salt ministry, get a hold of Rachel Roos. And then women of, is it the Women of Faith? What do you call your Bible study? Women's Bible study. Simple. Keep it simple. That's going to be 6:30. And what's the date on that? February 11th. So girls, you can come and have a really awesome time and get in the Word and just share your heart and pray together and have a really good time. I was really, really honored. I've had this vision of starting a men's ministry, a men's group on Saturday mornings. And Mark said, I'd love to head that up. And I said, go for it, David. And he of little faith. I had the podium set there and a little chair for him to sit on. He says, I'm not going to need that. And I said, why? He said, well, we can just sit here around the table. And I said, Mark, there's only 6 chairs around this table. Yeah. 22 guys showed up for men's breakfast. And girls, you ought to be clapping really hard. Because that was your man that was there. And if he wasn't there, encourage him to come the next time. Mark gave the statistic, 65% of our churches are women. Well, I think we're doing better than that at Destiny. I really, seriously, I do. But we encourage you men to come and be a part of that. There's nothing threatening there. It was just awesome. We had a really good discussion, good sausage and pancakes for breakfast, and we just ate and talked and shared our hearts. It's just my heart and my goal to have 80% of our men in this church be in that Bible study. It will forever change the world and change the church and change our families if we can get our men in this mindset of praising the Lord. So I just want to thank Mark and all the guys that showed up, and Larry and Brad Parks, they did the cooking out there on our new stove, and it just turned out awesome. This morning, we are in the 12th chapter of Acts. And Paul and Barnabas have gone to Antioch. And what's cool about Antioch, it was the first Christian church among the Gentiles. And the word Christian showed up in our scripture for the first time. It's one of 3 times in the whole Bible that the word Christian is used. It was the first Christian church that was to the Gentiles. And that was God's heart, not only for his chosen Jews to be part of the kingdom, but for all mankind. Jesus died for all mankind. And Paul and Barnabas discipled there for a year. This church was so on fire that they sent for Barnabas to minister to them and be their shepherd. And he calls for Paul to help him. They're so on fire. They're so desperate for the word of God that he calls for Paul, and Paul comes. And they minister to that congregation for a year constantly. And I don't know about any of you that haven't been on a missions trip, but for those of us that have been out of country on a missions trip, those people are starved for Jesus. And I'm telling you, they worship him with all their heart and all their might. They are so hungry for the word of Jesus. It's just amazing. And it's cool. Paul and Barnabas invested a year of their life in that church. There's a famine, and the church meets the need. And how cool is that? We talked about how government would be out of a job if the church was doing its job. And that's to take care of the poor, to clothe the naked, to feed the hungry. The government, Uncle Sam, wouldn't have anything to do much. God put authority into place. Go to Romans 13 and you can read that as a Bible study this week. God put that authority in place to protect you and me. He didn't put it in place to be our support system. We're to support it and honor the authority. The word gets out on how the church is growing and meeting the needs. And boy, does Herod get threatened. He is the government. And he's afraid that this powerful church through Jesus Christ and proclaiming the gospel is going to do away with their positions, their authority, their power. And the only way he knows to get rid of it is to kill it. And how many know that don't work? You can't kill enough people fast enough. If you don't believe it, look at the wars and the rumors of wars going on right now. And it isn't fixing anything. It's only making it worse. Herod hears of a huge following, and he's threatened and persecutes the church. He starts persecuting the church. He would send a bunch of guys in here right now while we're here and threaten us within an inch of our life. And then we'd have to make a decision. Are we going to follow Jesus, or are we going to bow to them? Oh my gosh, church, we need to be so thankful we're in a time such as this and in a country that we live in now. And somebody ought to be yelling amen really loud.
Amen.
Good. Thank you. That's where our scripture picks up today in Acts 12, verses 1 through 19. And we're going to read it. I've got about 10 points I want to make, and I'll try not to go on to 4 o'clock. It was about this time that King Herod arrested some who belonged to the church, intending to persecute them. That word intending is so powerful in all our lives. When we intend to do something, we usually carry it out, and that's not good. He had James, the brother of John, put to death with the sword. When he saw that this pleased the Jews, he proceeded to seize Peter also. This happened during the Feast of Unleavened Bread, which we know as Passover. After arresting him, he put him in prison, handing him over to be guarded by 4 squads of 4 soldiers each. Herod intended to bring him out for public trial after the Passover. Does that not sound how Jesus was treated and taken care of? So Peter was kept in prison, but the church was earnestly praying to God for him. Oh, that's awesome. The night before Herod was to bring him to trial, Peter was sleeping between 2 soldiers, bound with 2 chains, and the sentry stood guard at the entrance. Suddenly, an angel of the Lord appeared, and a light shone in the cell. He struck Peter on the side and woke him up. "Quick, get up," he said, and the chains fell off of Peter's wrists. Then the angel said to him, "Put on your clothes and sandals." And Peter did so. "Wrap your cloak around you and follow me," the angel told him. Peter followed him out of the prison, but he had no idea that what the angel was doing was really happening. He thought he was seeing a vision. They passed the 1st and 2nd guards and came to the iron gate leading to the city. It opened for them by itself, and they went through it. And when they had walked the length of the one street, suddenly the angel left him. Then Peter came to himself and said, "Now I know without a doubt that the Lord sent his angel and rescued me from Herod's clutches and from everything the Jewish people were anticipating." When this had dawned on him, he went to the house of Mary, the mother of John, also called Mark, where many people had gathered and were praying. Peter knocked at the outer entrance, and a servant girl named Rhoda came to answer the door. When she recognized Peter's voice, she was so overjoyed, she ran back without opening it and exclaimed, "Peter's at the door." "You're out of your mind," they told her. When she kept insisting that it was so, they said, "It must be his angel." But Peter kept on knocking, and when they opened the door and saw him, they were astonished. Peter motioned with his hand for them to be quiet and described how the Lord had brought him out of prison. Tell James and the brothers about this, he said, and then he left for another place. In the morning, there was no small commotion among the soldiers as to what had become of Peter. It was a big deal. It wasn't small, it says. After Herod had a thorough search made for him and did not find him, he cross-examined the guards and ordered that they be executed. What a powerful story. I want to talk to us today about prayer in the church. And I want it to be for us, Destiny Family of Faith. I want us to listen to this scripture and make sure that we don't fall into a pattern like some of this fell into, and then that we really completely immerse ourselves in some of the other patterns that are evident here. The first point I've got is worldly people have motives. Have any of you noticed that with the people you work with or people you've ever been around in school or just everyday life? People have motives, and they're not always good. Even people in the church can develop motives. They have a purpose, a plan. And it can be good or bad. We have to be careful to be in God's will. Worldly people have motives, and it's for self-gain. And Herod loved power, and he used it. And I have Romans 13 here written down, and I want you to study that this week and really get in your heart about the authority that's all of it's got appointed. We never can get enough power. I don't know about you all, but when we've gotten in a place, even as kids, I remember you getting picked on a ball team, or if you were the last one that nobody wanted. Can you remember that in your lives? Having that power to be the first one to be picked, or to not have the power enough, or the strength enough, or the ability enough to get picked? Power is strong in our hearts and in our minds and our flesh. And it could be used for good or it can be used for bad. And in the world, it gets used for bad. We never can get enough power. And he used his power, Herod, to see that John the Baptist was crucified. And now James. And we had two James mentioned there. One is James, the brother of John. And the other one is James, brother of Jesus. So there are two different James there, in case some of you got confused by that. He loved pleasing the Jewish leaders. Scripture says the Jewish people were happy. When he beheaded James and started persecuting the church, man, people got fired up. And these Jews, even though some of them had been saved, still hung on to that Jewish mindset, that Jewish law, that Jewish control. And even though they were trying to be set free, they hung on to that Jewish law. And if anybody was going against it, and somebody mentioned kill them, they were on board with it. That's how Jesus got killed. He's riding down on palm leaves on the donkey into town. And hours later, that crowd that cheered yells, crucify him. And it's this crowd that Herod sees being pleased again, not only after Jesus' death, but now after James and the persecuted church. And he was smart enough to do this persecution, it says, at Passover. And even though it relates to Jesus in that Passover time, the reason those guys did that is because all the Jews are gathered. They have a big crowd. And boy, when you do something and it's pleasing a few, why not please the whole bunch? So they pick a time to do it at Passover. All the people are gathered. The more power we have, the more we want to use it to impress. Man, it's fun to have a feather in your hat and have people say, good job, Mikey. And the more they pat you on the back, the more you do it, the more you do it, the more it happens, and it's just a vicious cycle. And if we're in the world, it's a bad cycle. And we can see it today. Our families, everybody is a sacrifice now. We're so far away from God's will in this country, it's just shameful. It's shameful. And we've got to get back to God's way. This worldly power has infiltrated our churches today, all over. There was a time that the church was a holy and righteous and upright place, and the world has infiltrated our churches. We're coming acting holier than thou and living like hell all week. And that can't go. I love John Hagee's wording. He said, this is not let's make a deal. This is the deal. And this scripture, this word of God is the deal. It isn't that we can be okay on Sunday morning and be here together and then go out there and do whatever we want to. It will bite us very soon. Satan, the next point is Satan loves to attack the powerful, I wrote. He doesn't need the weak. He needs the power. He needs to be going where the word is strong. So Herod sees the opportune time to attack the church and attack the leaders. That's where the opposition's coming from, so that's where they go to. A powerful church draws attention, and it also at the same time draws attack. So when we get spiritual attack from the outside, from the world, we can almost bet our booties that we're on track. We're doing something powerful for Jesus. Because if we're weak, if we're powerless, Satan doesn't need us. He's got us already. And you know, we get into a place to where we tell people,